Before we get started, I'm going to take a brief moment of point of personal privilege. In the Cardinal News this morning, there's an article about Virginia's connection with Hawaii and its history, some of which is good, some of which is not. But one of the interesting points is that the congressman from the 9th District of Virginia, the district I currently represent, a Democrat by the name of Jennings, was the only Virginian to vote for Hawaiian statehood. And so we're kind of proud of that, that our section of the state's a little different than the rest of the state. Sometimes good, sometimes bad, but mostly good. All right. That being said, if all of our guests would please take their seats. Subcommittee on Oversight and Investigations will now come to order, and I now recognize myself for 5 minutes for an opening statement. On August 7th and 8th, a series of fires broke out on the island of Maui and the island of Hawaii, including one that devastated the town of Lahaina on the west coast of Maui. While the Hawaiian Electric Company and the County of Maui dispute some facts surrounding these events, one thing is certain. This series of fires were catastrophic to the state of Hawaii, and we must make every effort to be vigilant and try and prevent a similar disaster from striking again. Tragically, the Lahaina fire took at least 97 lives, burned thousands of acres, caused billions of dollars in damage, and destroyed multiple native Hawaiian cultural and historical landmarks. I am deeply saddened to hear the stories of those who survived and awaiting news of their loved ones who still remain unaccounted for, who are still searching for housing, and who are wrestling with how they will survive after the fire consumed businesses and erased the island's tourism industry. While many continue to debate which exact decisions and circumstances contributed to the catastrophic scale of the Maui fires, it is not too early to start examining what can be done better. For example, some wildfire experts have noted that dense, flammable, non-native grasses have multiplied across the island in recent years, facilitating the deadly spread of the recent fires. Other reports have cited utility law experts who maintain that Hawaiian Electric waited too long to pursue important upgrades to harden and modernize the electric grid against wildfire risks. Still others have argued that Maui Electric Company, a subsidiary of Hawaiian Electric, was particularly slow in replacing outdated and deteriorating poles supporting its power lines. There were many decision makers involved along the way, and there is still much to sort out. To that end, Chair Rogers, Chair Duncan, and I probed some of the concerns in our August 30, 2023 letter to each of our invited witnesses, requesting additional information on their efforts to address wildfire risks on Maui. We thank our witnesses for their responses to our request, and I look forward to discussing the responses further today. Now I'd like to take a moment to introduce each of our witnesses for our first panel. We are joined today by Ms. Shelee Kimura, President and Chief Executive Officer at Hawaiian Electric Company. Hawaiian Electric Subsidiary Corporation Maui Electric Company provides service on Maui. Hawaiian Electric and its subordinate corporations provide service for 95% of Hawaii's residents. Finally, we also hear from somebody in there somewhere. We will also hear from Mr. Mark Glick, Energy Officer of Hawaii State Energy Office. The office develops support and supports state energy policy goals. We also welcome Mr. Leodoloff Asuncion, Jr., Chairman of the Hawaii Public Utilities Commission. Mr. Asuncion served as a commissioner since April of 2019, as his chair since July 2022. The commission, among other things, regulates the electricity rates and power service parameters of public utility companies operating in the state. Immediately after, we will convene a second panel consisting of testimony from our colleagues from the Hawaiian Congressional Delegation. Representative Ed Case from Hawaii's 1st District will testify. We will also hear testimony from Representative Jill Tokuda, whose 2nd District of Hawaii includes the island of Maui. There are several investigations underway and still a lot of debate and speculation around the days in which the fire spread and about what has been done or has not been done in years prior. However, Congress has a responsibility to pursue a safe national energy policy, which includes hardened electric infrastructure that is prepared for events like wildfires and hurricanes. Congress has a portion of that responsibility along with state regulators and private sector partners. Accordingly, it is extremely important that we convene today to begin to ask the hard questions. Given this committee's role in protecting our electric utility infrastructure and its general jurisdiction over power utilities, we will focus today on that aspect of the disaster. I hope that we learn here today, that what we learn here today will inform efforts at the federal, state, local, and utility level to protect constituents and ratepayers and reduce the chances of preventable losses of life and property to wildfires in the future. That said, I will also tell you that we have another hearing going on downstairs where we're looking at the electric grid, and so you will see members moving in and out because some members are on both subcommittees. I thank the witnesses for being here and participating in our efforts to learn from this horrible event and to prevent similar disasters from unfolding in such a deadly and destructive manner going forward. With that, I yield back and now recognize the ranking member of the subcommittee, Ms. Castor, for her five-minute opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, everyone. Just over 7 weeks ago, powerful wildfires devastated the town of Lahaina on the island of Maui in Hawaii. This was a sudden and horrific tragedy, and on behalf of the Democratic side, we extend our sincere condolences. Nearly 100 people died, and many more have lost their homes and businesses. The firsthand accounts of how quickly the fire spread and the chaos and confusion that resulted are horrendous. Many Hawaiian neighbors, military service, and Coast Guard members raced to rescue people that day. They worked through the smoke, flames, and pollution to save lives. They are heroes. Many others responded in the immediate aftermath, and more are on the ground now dedicated to recovery and relief. I understand that over 27 federal partners, including FEMA, EPA, the U.S. Army, and the Small Business Administration, are helping the people of Maui get back on their feet. And I appreciate the hands-on approach of Representatives Takuda and Case and Senators Hirono and Schatz on and how they are supporting and advocating for their neighbors. Top of mind for the Congress at this moment of a threatened government shutdown must be to ensure that the recovery work continues uninterrupted for the people of Maui. Today, I hope we can learn more about the conditions that caused the fire and what else Congress can do for the island. There are things that we do know already. We know that strong winds from a nearby hurricane combined with drought conditions and dry vegetation led to advanced warnings of fire on Maui. We know that the fire started on the edge of town in Lahaina on Maui's west coast and quickly grew out of control, ultimately devastating the town and claiming the lives of too many neighbors. Fire crews were dealing with another fire miles away. We know that people there are still suffering from the losses of their friends, families, and homes, and that firefighters are still working to contain wildfires elsewhere. What we do not know is the exact cause of the fire and what more, if anything, could have been done to prevent it from starting or spreading. Hawaiian Electric has said that one of its power lines ignited an earlier fire in Lahaina the morning of August 8th. The Maui Fire Department said it had extinguished that fire. But then fire was reported again in the same location and it quickly spread. While the National Weather Service in Honolulu began issuing alerts days before the Lahaina fire began, important questions remain about whether more could have been done to notify residents or de-energize power lines sooner. There are also critical questions about the steps local officials took in the 5 years since the wildfire struck Maui in 2018. These are important questions that are already being investigated. And while I strongly believe that we in Congress have an important oversight role to play, I do think it would have been helpful to have the benefit of the on-the-ground findings from the authorities before pulling the attention of our witnesses away from recovery efforts to appear before us. Nonetheless, I appreciate your willingness to be here today and hope we can learn more about this tragedy, whether and how it might have been prevented, and what can be done to prevent future tragedies like this, including insurance, ensuring that investments made for grid hardening under the bipartisan infrastructure law and the Inflation Reduction Act are delivered quickly and effectively. I would also like to learn more about how electric and other infrastructure can be rebuilt in a more resilient way. It's only been 7 weeks since the Lahaina fire, and the emergency is not over. Investigators deserve time to do their work thoroughly and present their findings. Until we get a clearer picture, our primary focus must continue to be on relief and recovery efforts for the people of Maui. And that includes keeping government open and ensuring that federal resources are available to them. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman, I yield back.
Shelee yields back. Now I recognize the chairwoman of the chair of the full committee, Ms. McMorris Rogers, for her 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chair Griffith. Critical. It's a critical one. We're examining the tragic events that unfolded on the Hawaiian island of Maui last month. On August 7th and 8th, a series of fires broke out on the island, including one that destroyed the town of Lahaina. Our deepest condolences to the people of Maui as they face the daunting task of rebuilding their communities, mourn the loss of loved ones, and grapple with the painful memories of that terrifying day. The pain of seeing your home and your neighbors' homes destroyed within a matter of hours or even minutes is gut-wrenching. At least 97 lives were lost to this disaster. And we continue to pray that God provide strength and comfort to their loved ones. Many are still missing. According to an estimate from the University of Hawaii's Pacific Disaster Center, at least 2,200 buildings were destroyed, with about 86% of those buildings being residential. We must do everything we can to minimize the chance that such a destructive and deadly disaster will occur again on Maui or anywhere else in the country. And unfortunately, if we fail to learn from this event, it very well could. The Hawaii Wildlife Management Organization reports that each year the percentage of total land burned by wildfire in Hawaii is equal to or greater than any other state in the nation. And according to the wildfires experts from the University of Hawaii, the area burned across all four counties in Hawaii each year has increased by 300% within the last several decades. Eastern Washingtonians are no strangers to the disastrous consequences of wildfires either. Last month, the Gray and Oregon Road fires destroyed hundreds of homes, forced evacuations, and have been linked to two deaths. Hundreds are still recovering from and coping with the destruction of these wildfires. While it's difficult to revisit the disaster that occurred on Maui, we must examine any factors that could have caused or worsened the emergency, identify any unnecessary hazards that were allowed to persist, and pinpoint any additional precautions that could have been taken. I understand debate about the factors behind the cause and spread of the fires continues, but that Hawaiian Electric acknowledged that an early morning fire on August 8th appears to have been caused by power lines that fell in high wind. What happened after that, particularly concerning the second fire that swept through Lahaina that afternoon and destroyed lives, and the town remains open to an investigation. Part of our job here in Congress is to ensure that every American has access to affordable and reliable energy, and that responsibility includes making sure that energy comes from safe, well-maintained infrastructure. There's been a lot of emphasis on some of the competing priorities when it comes to modernizing our electric grid in recent years. However, we must make sure that safety remains a top priority. A grid that's not prepared for extreme weather or is inadequately maintained is not only unreliable, but also an unacceptable safety hazard that could potentially cost billions of dollars and endanger lives. While we cannot prevent and control every hazard, such as the high winds that struck Maui leading up to the fire, we must harden our grid to hazards, address wildfire risks such as vegetation overgrowth, and implement appropriate precautions for extreme weather. We appreciate all the witnesses traveling across the country to be here today. You have a difficult road ahead of you in rebuilding after this tragic event. I hope that today we can learn how Congress can be a strong partner for utilities and state agencies in addressing grid safety concerns. And while there's other investigations ongoing, we hope that this hearing provides some clarity on how and why this disaster unfolded in such a catastrophic manner and what steps can be taken to minimize the likelihood of it occurring again. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Gentlelady yields back. Now recognize the ranking member of the full committee, Mr. Pallone, for his 5-minute opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The wildfires that swept through the town of Lahaina on August 8th were a catastrophic disaster, and I want to offer my deepest sympathies to all those affected. It's a devastating tragedy, and we must ensure that Congress supports the island every way we can. There are many unanswered questions about how this terrible tragedy happened, and I'm not going to go through all the things that have already been mentioned, my colleagues, in terms of what actually happened or what we know. But I know that first responders tried to contain the blaze, and some residents were able to evacuate, but tragically it wasn't enough, and the fire went completely out of control. I also want to say that we can't overestimate or overstate the enormity of the disaster and the destruction it brought, and the fact that so many people died and are still missing, and that many of the deceased have not been identified. And many residents are living in temporary shelters because their homes are gone. Officials estimate that over 2,000 structures were damaged or destroyed. It's going to be a very long road to rebuild. And emergency responders, as has been mentioned, are still working day and night to fight the ongoing fires in remote areas of the island. And many factors appear to have contributed to the catastrophic scale of this fire. The extremely high winds pushing flames through dry vegetation rapidly escalated the fire's spread and prevented successful firefighting efforts. Evacuation routes were blocked by police due to downed trees and power lines, which resulted in bottlenecks and gridlocks on the few roads in and out of Lahaina. And power outages and damaged cell towers exacerbated communication problems and created further confusion. We do not know why emergency sirens were not activated to warn residents, or what role the electric grid may have played in sparking the fire that ultimately destroyed Lahaina. In terms of a government response, the acting governor declared a state of emergency the day the fire started, and 2 days later, Governor Green requested a disaster declaration, which was immediately granted by the Biden administration. Within 48 hours, FEMA was on the ground in Maui, assembling crews for search and rescue and survivor assistance. Several official investigations are underway to get to the bottom of this disaster. Hawaii's Attorney General has commissioned the Fire Safety Research Institute to conduct a thorough examination of the causes. It's expected to make multiple interim reports before issuing a final report and recommendations around August of next year. Those on the ground with the most information and experience are the appropriate authorities to examine the causes of the fire, and I look forward to hearing from our witnesses. But I am concerned that this hearing is shifting attention and resources away from ongoing relief efforts on Maui and the official investigations that are still in their early stages. Congress should focus on ensuring that the federal government can continue providing relief to the people of Maui. And that means funding the government and funding FEMA's Disaster Relief Fund, which the President has asked us to do. And that is something specific that we and only we can and should do without delay. A reckless government showdown, or shutdown, I should say, which we know is imminent, would slow Maui's ability to rebuild and recover. And after all, this disaster is not over. Thousands of people are displaced and in desperate need of permanent housing. Firefighters are still working, and utility crews are working to restore power and repair damaged infrastructure. So I'm hopeful that the investigations will provide answers so that we can learn from this tragedy to ensure this does not happen again. But right now, we must do all that we can to support the residents of Maui recover and rebuild. And a shutdown is not the answer, obviously. I mean, it's hard for us here in the midst of this potential shutdown to be talking about how much we can do, because we don't know if government is going to be able to do anything if by tomorrow night or Saturday the government shut down. That's certainly not, you know, it's not easy for us to say to you that we're going to help when we don't even know if the government's going to be open. So I guess my main thing, and I know it sounds political, but I can't help it, because if the government shuts down, it's a serious question about what we're actually going to do. But in any case, we appreciate everybody being here, and we are determined to do whatever we can to help. So thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman. Gentleman yields back. That concludes members' opening statements. The chair would like to remind members that pursuant to committee rules, all members' written opening statements will be made a part of the record. Please provide those to the clerk promptly. Again, we want to thank our witnesses for being here today and taking the time to testify before this subcommittee. You will have an opportunity to give an opening statement followed by a round of questions from our members. Our witnesses today are Ms. Shelee Kimura, President and Chief Executive Officer of Hawaiian Electric; Mr. Mark B. Glick, Chief Energy Officer, Hawaii State Energy Office; and Mr. Leodoloff Asuncion, Jr., Chair of the Hawaii Public Utilities Commission. We appreciate you all being here, and I look forward to hearing from you. You're aware that this subcommittee is holding our oversight hearing, and when doing so, we have the practice of taking testimony under oath. Do any of you have an objection to taking testimony under oath or giving your testimony under oath? Seeing no objection, we'll proceed. I would also advise you that you're entitled to be advised by counsel pursuant to House rules. Do any of you desire to be advised by counsel during your testimony today? All right, I don't see any asking for that, so if you all would please stand and raise your right hand. Do you promise to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? Seeing the witnesses all answered in the affirmative, you are now sworn. You may sit down. You're now sworn in and under oath, subject to the penalties set forth in Title 18, Section 1001 of the United States Code. With that, we will now recognize Ms. Kimura for her five-minute opening statement.
Thank you, Chair Griffith.
If you push your mic, yeah.
Is it working?
It's not loud enough. Maybe you can pull it a little closer to you.
Is that better?
It's a little better. What do our technicians say? Are we okay?
Testing.
I think we're good. Go ahead.
Better? Okay. Aloha and good morning. On August 8th in Lahaina, Maui, we saw human loss and devastation at a speed and scale that is difficult for our hearts and minds to process. I want to start by honoring those lost and those whose lives have been forever changed by this overwhelming and tragic event. Most of you know the word aloha. There is another word in the Hawaiian language, kuleana. Loosely translated, this word means responsibility. But like aloha, it cannot be simply defined. It is a deep sense of responsibility that is both an obligation and a privilege. It's a responsibility that has been entrusted to you by your family, by your community, by the generations that came before you and those that will follow you. Kuleana is one's responsibility within a bigger system or community to which one belongs. It's a privilege to have kuleana within this interdependent system and to one another. For generations past, present, and future, Hawaiian Electric's kuleana is to Hawaii. We are committed to be there for Maui and Lahaina for as long as it takes to recover, to rebuild, and to help ensure a tragedy like this never happens again. In that spirit, I hope all of us can see it as our shared kuleana, our responsibility to honor the people of Lahaina as we do this work as part of a collective community. I hope we can start to find solutions that will help protect Hawaii and the rest of the nation from increasing threats of familiar natural disasters like hurricanes and those that we have rarely experienced, including droughts that can fuel catastrophic wildfires on tropical islands. Hawaii is the most isolated population on Earth. There's no electrical connection to the continental US or even between islands. This is one of the reasons Hawaii has the highest electric rates in the nation. On an island, we have to be our own safety net. We can't call on a neighboring state if we run short. Our isolation is also one of the drivers for our efforts to become energy independent, to get off expensive, volatile, imported fossil fuels. It's not only about the environment, but about our economy and energy security. As utilities go, we're small, about 470,000 customers on five islands, 70,000 on Maui. The Department of Defense is our largest customer. Hawaii is home to the U.S. Indo-Pacific Command, and we are the only utility in the nation serving all components of one combatant command. I became president and CEO of Hawaiian Electric in January of 2022. Every day, I feel a tremendous kuleana responsibility to our customers, communities, and employees. Since August 8th, I've spent much of my time on Maui. I've seen the devastation firsthand. Our team, including our Maui employees who have been personally impacted by this tragedy, has been working tirelessly to support our communities. We all want to learn what happened on August 8th so that it never happens again. On that day, a fire at 6:30 a.m., what I will refer to as the morning fire, appears to have been caused by Hawaiian Electric power lines that fell in high winds. The Maui County Fire Department promptly responded to this fire. They reported that by 9 a.m. it was contained. After monitoring it for several hours, the fire department determined the fire had been extinguished. They left the scene in the early afternoon. At about 3 p.m., a time when all of Hawaiian Electric's power lines in West Maui had been de-energized for more than 6 hours, a second fire, the afternoon fire, began in the same area. The cause of that afternoon fire that spread to Lahaina has not been determined. We are working tirelessly to figure out what happened, and we are cooperating fully with federal and state investigators who have indicated it may take 12 to 18 months to conclude. I look forward to fulfilling our shared and respective kuleana to honor the people of Maui as we seek solutions to protect Hawaii and the rest of the nation from other deadly disasters. Mahalo.
Thank the gentlelady. Now recognize Mr. Glick for his 5-minute opening statement.
Chairwoman McMorris Rogers, Chairman Duncan, Chairman Griffith, Ranking Member Pallone, Ranking Member Castor, members of the committee. My name is Mark Glick, and I'm Chief Energy Officer of the Hawaii State Energy Office. As noted in my response to the committee's letter of August 30th, my office appreciates the thorough exploration of the causes and effects of the tragic events that occurred on August 8, 2023, and we share the nation's resolve to stand with the people of Lahaina in their request to heal, grieve, and recover. I'd like to highlight a few points for the committee. A driving force for Hawaii's aggressive pursuit of energy self-sufficiency is due to our deep concern over oil price volatility, which is extremely detrimental to our economy and our cost of living. Hawaii's oil has been and continues to be sourced primarily from Africa, Europe, and Asia, and the run-up of oil prices due to Russia's invasion of Ukraine had resulted in 40% higher diesel costs on the island of Molokai in Maui County, which has only 18% renewable energy. On the flip side, the island of Kauai, with 60% renewable energy, only experienced a 5% increase in energy costs during the same time and has the lowest average electricity rates in the state. In other words, adopting renewables in Hawaii is a low-cost energy solution while achieving other policy objectives. Hawaii's new normal with wildfires, long a real threat, was first realized with Hurricane Lane in August of 2018 and the California wildfires. It's now recognized that Hawaii's wet and dry periods are more pronounced, and for the first time, wildfire risk was ranked equivalent to hurricane, tsunami, floods, and earthquakes. Since the deadly fire in Lahaina, the Energy Office has participated in discussions with the Attorney General and other parties and is aware that investigations are ongoing with respect to Hawaiian Electric's actions. Therefore, it would be inappropriate for the Energy Office to comment on those issues at this time. We take an all-hazards approach to resilience and serve as emergency support function number 12 within FEMA's National Disaster Recovery Framework. Our broader mission is to help mitigate and respond to threats on energy resilience, focusing on energy security plans and response efforts. In that role, we have previously flagged invasive grasses and vegetation on the island of Maui and elsewhere in Hawaii as resilience threats. But I should make it clear, the Energy Office does not have any authority for oversight or enforcement of the utilities or the private sector on energy matters. We have also seen no evidence thus far that indicates renewable energy development has restricted available funds for vegetation management. A key Energy Office resilience efforts was participation in July of 2019 to November 2021 in the Resilience Working Group, established as part of Hawaii Electric's integrated grid planning process with oversight by the Hawaii PUC. The working group considered hurricanes, earthquakes, tsunamis, volcanoes, wildfires, and physical and cyber attacks as the greatest threats to grid resilience and recommended a set of resilience measures, including those addressing vegetation management. Among those recommendations are plans for enhanced vegetation management, particularly in critical grid areas, continue to harden and reinforce critical transmission circuit and upgrade structures, continue planning for expanding water-resistant underground cables, establish priority circuits with enhanced restoration capabilities and greater hardening, consider adopting advanced technologies and a more distributed resource approach, including microgrids for emergency and backup operations, and develop wildfire mitigation strategies for a worst-case wildfire event at Ma'alea, a location just 16 miles south of Lahaina. The working group emphasized that infrastructure owners and operators must work together in close partnerships to coordinate disaster planning and recovery with the shared responsibilities between the power companies, key customers, and the government. The final consolidated integrated grid plan was submitted to the Hawaii PUC by Hawaiian Electric on May 12th of this year and is currently under review by the Hawaii PUC. The Energy Office is now completing the Oahu Energy System and Critical Infrastructure Vulnerability and Resilience Assessment, a FEMA-funded effort. This assessment of Oahu's major energy supply, distribution, and demand networks and the state's critical infrastructure risks covers electricity, liquid, and gas energy infrastructure. Once completed, the Energy Office plans to follow up, pending FEMA approval, with a second phase of analysis for Kauai, Maui, and Hawaii counties. In conclusion, it's clear that a multi-pronged approach to prevent, mitigate, and respond to wildfire threats is necessary, involving both short-term and long-term actions. These solutions require a shared commitment of private and public sector will and resources to adequately safeguard our essential energy infrastructure. In the response efforts related to the Maui and Hawaii County wildfire tragedy, Hawaii expresses its sincere gratitude to the federal assistance we have received thus far, and we humbly request your future support and assistance as we recover and rebuild. I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank the gentleman. I now recognize Mr. Asuncion for his 5-minute opening statement.
Thank you. Chair Griffith, Ranking Member Castor, members of the subcommittee. On behalf of the Hawaii Public Utilities Commission, I wish to express our appreciation for the sincere outpouring of support for our communities in the wake of this tragedy. We appreciate this committee's focus on this issue and the opportunity to speak to you as addressing the increasing number and magnitude of natural disasters requires unprecedented levels of collaborative action. We are still grappling with the devastation of this tragedy, and our hearts remain with all of the victims and their loved ones. These communities have been irreversibly impacted, and we intend to maintain our focus on supporting them as the months and years go by. In my statement, and you do have a copy of my written statement, the Commission wishes to share with this subcommittee its perspective on the following three topics. First, the Commission's role and jurisdiction to regulate Hawaii electric utilities, particularly as it relates to natural disaster preparedness, safety, reliability, and resilience. Second, the Commission's priorities in responding to the August wildfires that include addressing immediate needs, preventing future catastrophic events, ensuring reliable, safe, clean, and affordable energy services, and protecting ratepayers by utilizing investigative findings to guide potential restoration actions. And third, the Commission's activities to mitigate the risk of wildfires that may be caused by or impact the electric grid. The Commission and myself looks forward to answering any questions about these and other topics during this hearing, as well as collaborating on an ongoing basis to ensure the events like the Maui wildfires or any other natural disasters never occur again. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank the gentleman for his opening statement, and thank you all for your testimony. We'll now move to the question and answer portion of the hearing, and I will begin the questioning and recognize myself for 5 minutes. So my congressional district in Southwest Virginia is mountainous, rural, spread out, and is actually by land mass larger than Hawaii. So I can understand some of the problems and concerns that you all have. But the picture I get is that there were lots of warning signs out there that wildfires were a prominent threat, particularly on that end of Maui. So I guess, Ms. Kimura, do you all gather information in real time on weather reports when planning preventive maintenance and power generation activities? And before a storm like this, do you have plans in place to watch what's happening and what's going to occur? Because we know the National Weather Service was telling folks a couple of days in advance this was going to be a big one.
Thank you for that question. So we do monitor. We were very aware of the red flag warning of the high winds. Forecasters were indicating that it would be 35 to 45 mile per hour winds with gusts of 60 miles per hour. They later indicated, as this was happening, that they had then forecasted that parts of the state were experiencing much higher winds and gusts of about 80 miles per hour.
When did you get that information? And were you all watching this yourselves? Was somebody monitoring that on a minute-by-minute basis?
We have our teams, not me personally.
Yes, ma'am.
We have our teams that are getting the information from the from third parties. It's not our own team looking at it, but they're getting it from third parties looking at that.
Do you know when you learned that the winds were going to be higher than you originally anticipated?
I don't have that information right now.
Did you get that to the committee after this hearing, obviously?
Absolutely follow up with you.
Yeah. And here's the reason I ask. We get snowstorms. Y'all don't have that one. But we get snowstorms, and our school systems often will be watching the weather forecast, and even before the first flake drops, if they see significant weather, they shut the school systems down. And so my question is, what was the decision-making process in not de-energizing or shutting the power off in this area, which already, because of the invasive plants, because of the wooden poles, because the wires, the lines weren't insulated, already was at risk? These were all risks that were known. What was the decision-making process not to de-energize or turn the power off on these lines during that critical period?
So in 2019, our teams, understanding what happened in...
And I appreciate the history. What I'm trying to figure out is on that morning, what was your strategy? And were there people who were awake all night monitoring this storm to see what we could do? What's going on? Tell us and the American people what was going on that morning and why you didn't de-energize earlier.
Absolutely. I'm trying to explain to
you
why we didn't.
Well, I understand you're going to the process. I'm trying to figure out what happened that day back in August.
Yeah. So I'm trying to answer your question about why we didn't de-energize.
Okay.
Those decisions were made years before as part of a plan and as part of our protocols. And so I'm trying to help you understand what our protocols are in that kind of situation. So in 2019, our team started developing a wildfire mitigation plan. And based on what they had learned of the plans in California, including their preemptive shutoff programs, they determined...
That would be the PSPS.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
PSPS. That wasn't the appropriate fit for Hawaii. Hawaii is very unique, and through that process, that's the determination that was made, and we had other protocols in place when there's high winds. So when you're asking why didn't we shut off the power, that is not our protocol to do that.
All right, let's stop right there.
Okay.
Going forward, are you re-examining that? Are you looking at doing the public safety power shutoff programs? Are you looking at that now? And are you re-examining your protocols because they didn't work?
We are absolutely re-examining our protocols. I want to make it absolutely clear that the afternoon fire, the cause of that fire has not yet been determined.
I heard your testimony, and I just want to confirm, you never re-energized your power lines once you shut them down. Is that correct?
That's right.
And a little bit
before 7 a.m., our lines were not re-energized.
And how long did it take for the energy to get out of those power lines? I understand it takes some time. Once you push the button to turn it off, how long does it take where the lines are no longer a danger to the public or to the firefighters, et cetera?
I don't know that exact answer,
but I can guarantee you. If you could get that for me
later. Yeah.
All right, and I apologize, but my time is up, and so I have to yield, even though I'm the subcommittee chair. I have to follow the clock, too, and I now yield back and recognize Ms. Castor, ranking member, for her 5 minutes of questions. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much. I also want to focus on the conditions prior to the fire. I actually was in Honolulu on August 8th at Indo-Pacific Command with General Aquilino and on a bipartisan CODEL as we were headed to the Pacific Rim, and it was extraordinarily windy, and everyone was commenting on it, and they didn't have an understanding yet of the extent of the devastation in Lahaina, but officials had been warning about the likelihood of high winds and wildfire risk for a couple of days. So the information we have is that on August 6th, the National Weather Service warned of fire conditions due to severe drought and strong winds. On August 7th, the National Weather Service issued a red flag warning indicating severe fire risk. So you said HECO was aware of these warnings from the National Weather Service, correct?
That's right.
And so I want to dive in. The protocols did, what exactly were the protocols on the books that ensured when you received these warnings that action was going to be taken immediately?
Yeah, so the protocols on the books for many years was to disable the automatic a setting on our system that automatically recloses a circuit if there's a fault, meaning that if there's a fault indicated on the line, that it won't re-energize. The breaker were open, and then it won't re-energize.
And then how quickly after you received the warning did you act to do that?
I don't know the exact time. I believe the warning, and we can subject to check, I believe the warning happened overnight, and by the morning that those protocols were put into place. But we can get that for you, those
Thank
details
you. Mr. Asuncion, does HECO have the authority to proactively de-energize its lines in response to weather conditions?
Excuse me, can you repeat that question?
Does HECO have the authority to proactively de-energize the lines when they receive these warnings?
Yes, they do.
Okay. Ms. Kimura, when did HECO first become aware that one of its power lines was down in Lahaina?
We had a number of power lines coming down, and I'm trying to remember when the first one was down, and I can't recall right now. I mean, there was a lot happening from August 7th to August 8th.
Mr. Asuncion, do you know exactly when? When did you receive notice?
I received notice of lines going down or basically in the afternoon of the 8th when HECO informed us that they activated their incident management team.
Last year, HECO submitted a plan to the PUC to spend $189 million on grid hardening to make its energy grid more resilient. And last month, DOE announced $95 million, U.S. DOE announced $95 million to Lahaina coming from the bipartisan infrastructure law. Ms. Kimura, can you describe HECO's proposed grid hardening plan and what steps you had already taken to improve your lines prior to the fire and how you intend to use these federal investments?
So the federal investment that we were informed of, we don't yet have it. We're in discussions on when we will get that or how we will get that. But that is going to help fund our transmission and distribution resilience program. And that is a multi-year program that we have in front of the Public Utilities Commission. We had filed for approval for that program in June of 2022. And that program was a result of years of work, including a lot of work with stakeholders as well. And that program includes addressing critical transmission and distribution infrastructure.
Okay, and they, but you had not, you had been working, you said yourself you've been working on this for a number of years. You weren't waiting for these federal dollars, hopefully. You had, what work had been underway already to protect against wildfire risk?
So we had been starting work, or we had been in process on doing work. A utility is always doing hardening work. The proposal was to increase and further the work that we're doing.
Do you have that plan in writing on what had been proposed specifically for Maui and what work had been completed?
We have the work in writing that had been proposed. We also have our wildfire mitigation plan, and we had begun implementing that even before the approval of that plan.
Thank you very much. I think the committee would like to see those documents, the plan that had been composed for years ahead of time, and then exactly what work had been taken in advance prior to these devastating fires.
We'd be happy to provide that to you.
Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you for agreeing to provide that information. And I recognize the chairwoman of the full committee, Ms. McMorris-Rogers, for her 5 minutes of questioning.
Mr. Glick, in your written testimony, you state that your office actively develops policies to achieve renewable energy and energy resiliency with the legislature, Public Utilities Commission, state agencies, and other relative stakeholders. In filing submitted to the Hawaii Public Utilities Commission last year, Hawaiian Electric stated most storm damage tends to be due to trees that are outside of the right-of-way. Utility best practice is to identify and proactively remove these trees, with the removal being paid for by the utility. A robust hazard tree program can greatly reduce the amount of damage that occurs during a major storm. Additionally, in the response to the committee's question about the vegetation management, Hawaiian Electric stated, the vast bulk of invasive grasses on the island of Maui are not on land owned or controlled by Hawaiian Electric. The utility also added, eliminating vegetation, such as grasses, present in easements and right-of-way, but not tall enough to contact the lines, is not generally within Hawaiian Electric rights. A 2021 report on wildfire prevention by the Maui County Cost of Government Commission concluded above-ground power lines that fail, short, or are low-hanging can cause fire ignition, sparks that could start a wildfire, particularly in wind or stormy conditions. This condition is exacerbated by overgrown areas in the right-of-way beneath lines. So, Mr. Glick, would you agree that preventing damage to power lines by vegetation and preventing the spread of wildfires that could destroy electric infrastructure is a resilience issue?
Yes, yeah, certainly vegetation management is critical and can cause damage to power lines.
Thank you. Does your office plan to review potential policy changes that may be needed to address hazard trees near utilities, rights-of-way, and flammable overgrown vegetation in the vicinity of electric infrastructure?
Yeah, we're certainly aware of great investments that Hawaiian Electric and our other utility, Kauai Island Utility Cooperative, have made in Hawaiian Electric's case, particularly on Hawaii Island, with albizia removal. Albizia trees are invasive trees that have caused great damage. And, you know, our policies will, our look into policy changes will continue to look at ways to also work with the private landowners and to try to have more cooperative efforts, because a lot of these, everything doesn't happen, as you mentioned, in the right of ways.
Right. Right, thank you. So, Ms. Kimura, You know, if there are, for example, the overgrown shrubs or an abundance of dry grasses under Hawaiian electric lines, but not tall enough to actually contact the lines, you maintain that the company cannot do anything about them, and that's what it sounds like was cited and based on a Hawaiian electric response. I just wanted to give you a moment to elaborate on that.
Thank you for the opportunity. So our easements and rights of way allow us to clear vegetation. So our vegetation management is around our lines. It does not give us the right, it is not a stated right to take care of the grass under our lines on private property. And so that is an issue that I think we all in our state need to be looking at. Now, given what happened on August 8th, and we all agree that that's a critical issue for everyone to be looking at.
Great, thank you. I understand Hawaiian Electric mentioned hazard tree removal in its application before the Public Utilities Commission for Climate Adaptation, Transmission, and Distribution Resilience Program. I understand the application has not yet been approved. Is that correct?
That's correct. It's in process.
Currently, what does Hawaiian Electric do if its employees or contractors identify a tree that appears to be at risk of contacting one of Hawaiian Electric lines should it fall, whether due to poor condition or extreme weather?
I'd have to get back to you on exactly what happens. We recently had an issue where there was a tree as a result of the fires in upcountry Maui that was at risk of falling. We had contractors go out there and take down the line, but the property owner was also there and indicating that this tree was at risk.
Would you speak to the policy before the fires, how the utility would have responded?
The reason why we're going to get approval for hazard tree removal, as I understand it, is because we are not, at this point, allowed to go ahead and do that as part of a larger program.
Thank
you. Given our rights of way and our easements.
More questions to come. At this point, though, my time has expired. I yield back.
Thank you, gentlelady, for yielding back. Now I recognize Ms. Schakowsky for her 5 minutes of questioning.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I really want to thank the witnesses and the tragedy that you have faced and the community sentiments that must be so overwhelming. I want to say my condolences for the loss of life and the loss of history in such a beautiful community. One of the things that really shocked me was that there was some misinformation that was being spread at the time. I don't know if this actually became an issue. I did want to ask you about it. I know that there were some social media generated by China and other malicious actors who were actually saying that there was it was caused by government space lasers discouraging some people from dealing with FEMA, and that kind of misinformation, disinformation that was being circulated. How shameful is that? But I just wanted to ask any or all of you if this disinformation had any effect, if you had to deal with that at the same time as trying to address the tragedy and the things that happened afterwards and all the work that you had to do in order to do the best for your communities. So if you had any comments on that, hopefully it was not had a big effect, but let me hear from you.
I can start. I mean, this is not an area of my expertise, but I have been on the ground in Lahaina, and I have been talking with people. So it is very distracting, and it creates divide in the community. And in a time where people need to come together and support the community, it does create noise that makes it much more difficult for that to happen. And just talking about it personally for our own company, I recall having conversations. We would gather every morning in Maui in a big circle at 7 a.m. before the crews went out. And I remember having to tell them, stay focused on your work, be safe, don't let all of that noise in social media distract you and bother you, because we have work to do and we need to stay focused on serving our community. And I'm sure that's the kind of conversations others that are helping the community needed to have as well.
Anybody else? The other thing I wanted to mention, so all of the investigation is not complete. What kind of impact does that have on your testimony today? What are we waiting for? What might you find out that has not yet been revealed because there is not yet a complete investigation? Can you answer that about the, yes?
It's difficult to speculate on what might be found or what might not be found. This is a very complex situation, as you've been hearing from many of the members here. I've talked about in my opening statement being a part of a system and a community. There's a system here that was in play for all of these conditions to happen all at one time, that resulted in the devastation in Lahaina. And there's a lot to unpack there. It's very complex. Many people, many different organizations are involved, and many conditions are involved. And all of that needs to be taken into account. And those are all critically important to understand, and how all of that works together as an interdependent system for us to figure out the right solutions for Hawaii as well.
How soon do you think that you're going to get the final information from which you can plan ahead on the changes that need to be made?
The Attorney General, who's doing one of the investigations, Hawaii State Attorney General, and the ATF, who's supporting the Maui County Fire Department and the County of Maui, I understand that they are both saying it'll take 12 to 18 months. And so we're still in the very early stages. We expect ours to take many months as well.
Thank you. My time has expired. I yield back. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlelady, for yielding back. And now recognize Dr. Burgess of Texas for his 5 minutes of questioning.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you for holding this hearing today. It is important, and I appreciate our witnesses being here. Is there ever any option to bury these delivery lines? Are they always going to be above ground, or is it just too cost prohibitive to bury the lines? And yeah, from all of you, actually.
So the standard is on Maui is for lines to be overhead. A customer can opt to have it undergrounded. They have to pay for that undergrounding. It is very expensive. So some customers opt to do that, and they pay for that. About 50% of the lines on Maui are undergrounded. 50%. In comparison, as I understand it, California is about 33% undergrounded.
So you have more underground delivery water?
Yes.
I mean, obviously some of this infrastructure is going to have to be replaced as you rebuild. Again, I would just ask, is undergrounding a consideration during the rebuild?
As I've talked to some community members in Lahaina, they would like to have the lines undergrounded, understandably. These are conversations that we're going to have to continue to have, and solutions we're going to have to figure out. Undergrounding, in general, is about 5 times more expensive. And on a small island like Maui, with only 70,000 customers, that can get very expensive. Sure. In a place where we have the highest rates in the nation. and we're already facing an economy where many of our people who have lived in Hawaii for a long time can no longer afford to live in Hawaii. So those are the kinds of considerations we have when we make these kinds of decisions and the kinds of conversations we need to have as a community to make sure that we're doing the right thing and the best thing for that community.
Thank you for that answer. Mr. Asuncion, in your statement, you said that the commission, of which your chair, is going to take a proactive approach to ensure that Hawaii Electric mitigates its risk. I'd like for you to elaborate on that a little bit and then just add, is undergrounding of the utility one of those measures?
Yeah, you know, like Ms. Kimura said, I think we look at all aspects of whether or not, right, it goes underground. Like she said, there is that option, right, if the customer does want to have it underground, certainly we'll put it underground. And we do, like a lot of our newer communities across the state, right, mm-hmm. we have it underground versus overhead. It does come at some costs, right, to the ratepayer, to the company, basically to all of us in the state of Hawaii. One of our things is really looking at the cost, but I will say as an urban planner and knowing the conditions underground, especially in Hawaii, mm-hmm. you hit the water table pretty quickly.
Sure.
So those are other considerations, more technical considerations that we need to look at. There is a cost to maintaining those lines underground.
Sure.
So all of that is wrapped up, in how we look at, the work that Hawaiian Electric will do, or even our cooperative on the island of Kauai, right? It's all the same considerations, right? At the end of the day, are we impacting the ratepayers greatly just for that island, right? We don't have like subsidizing of island, another island grid towards one. So at the end of the day.
I get it, but sometimes the cost of doing nothing turns out to be prohibitive also. Let me just ask you, because does the age of the line make a difference? And I don't know the term for it, but the amount of the coefficient of sag in the line, does it increase as the line ages?
I wouldn't be able to tell you that. I'm not the technical person.
But the comment was made in some of your testimony that some of this infrastructure is getting pretty old. Is that
yes.
fair to say?
Yes.
And so the brittleness of the line, the likelihood that it might break, again, whatever term I'm not aware of, the sag coefficient is going to increase. Where vegetation that may not have posed a problem when the line was installed now may, because the actual physical configuration of the line is different. Is that a fair concern?
Yes, it's fair. And, I think, some of those lines, depending on the age, right, they had a different type of standard or code at the time. Our rules are prospective, right? So if they're going to be doing maintenance, if Hawaiian Electric or the cooperative is going to be doing maintenance on the lines, installing new lines, it's getting up to that particular code at that time, right? So if the coefficient, if you want to call it, right, of sag is different today, right, we would expect our utilities to build to the current standard.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Now recognize the ranking member of the full committee, Mr. Pallone of New Jersey, for his 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I guess I reiterate again that I appreciate the witnesses being here and helping us understand what we can do in Congress to help with this catastrophe. But I can't help think that you might be better off being at home, and we'd be better off if we could figure out how to avoid this shutdown. So again, appeal to my colleagues on the other side to work with us to prevent the shutdown. But in any case, Ms. Kimura, I know there are many details still to be uncovered, but I'd like to ask you about the electrification of HCO's power lines. I understand that HCO has taken responsibility for the brush fire that broke out before 7 a.m. on August 8th near Lahaina Luna Road. Is that correct? And will you explain what led HCO to this conclusion?
So we have a team doing an investigation, and many have also seen a video that a resident had taken in that area. In high winds, our lines fell to the ground, and it appears that a fire was sparked in that area.
So it's clearly... I'm sorry.
No, I was just going to explain that it started on a grassy area between a sidewalk and a road, and then what we think is it traveled up to the adjacent field that was behind one of the homes, and as we understand it, it turned into about a 3-acre fire, and the fire department was able to contain it and then extinguish it.
So it's clear then that your lines were energized before 7 a.m. on August 8th, and that fire was eventually contained by the Maui Fire Department and monitored for hours until early that afternoon. But then around 3 p.m., HCO employees reported a fire in the same area as the earlier fire, and this is the blaze that then grew out of control and eventually destroyed Lahaina. Is that accurate?
That's okay. Right. And by that time, at 3 p.m., our lines had been out for over 6 hours.
Okay, because they were already de-energized at that time.
De-energized, yes.
So can you explain what exactly when exactly HCO shut the power off to its lines that day? When did that happen?
So just before 7 a.m., none of our lines in the West Maui area serving customers were energized.
And how can you confirm that the lines were not energized at that time?
This is based on a lot of our system data, so our SCADA data, our smart meters, and discussions with our employees. And so that's part of the information that we looked at this from all angles because it was such a critical fact. And so we made sure that we looked at that very closely, and we're making our information available to the ATF.
So, I mean, it's still important for the fire investigators to determine the role of these power lines. So have you agreed to cooperate with all the investigations into this matter?
Absolutely. We've been fully cooperating and making our information available to them.
And is HECO still conducting an internal investigation into the overall events of that day?
Yes, we're still early in our investigation.
And when do you expect to have results from your internal investigation? And do you commit to make those public when you have the results?
I don't have an exact timeline on how long it will take, but we expect that it'll take many months to get done. And I'm sure that there will be more to talk about once we know what the results of those
are. You've committed or you are willing to commit to make those results public once the investigation is completed?
I think it's too early to speculate on exactly what comes out of this and what form it comes out, but we are committed to sharing what's critical with the public on this.
Is there any reason why you wouldn't make it public? I mean, you seem to be hesitating a little bit.
I think it's just too early to speculate on what that is going to look like in the future. We're very focused on finding out what happened there to make sure that it never happens again.
All right. I'm just going to conclude, Mr. Chairman, again, that, you know, we pledge to be a partner to the people of Maui as they recover and rebuild, do whatever we can to help on both sides of the aisle here. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. The ranking member yields back, and I will recognize myself for 5 minutes for questions. And I'm going to talk about, to Ms. Kimura, I want to ask you these questions. And it's about remote, how we monitor remote areas. I'm from Kentucky. We have a lot of rural areas as well with power lines. So just kind of interested moving forward. So just to establish it, I believe, Ms. Kimura, that Hawaiian Electric and its subsidiaries have equipment running through remote territory. Is that correct?
I'm sorry, can you...
You have equipment running through remote territory.
Yes.
So I'd like to learn more about how you monitor that and its grid for potential problems. New sources have reported that on Monday, August the 7th at 10:47 p.m., a security camera at the Maui Bird Conservation Center caught a bright flash in the woods, and one person at that location stated the power then went out, and the surrounding forest was on fire shortly after that. Was Hawaiian Electric aware of an incident involving its power lines at that time?
I do not know what was known right at that moment. We would have had a fault indicated, but I can't tell you exactly what our personnel knew right in that moment.
Did the personnel know of it from some kind of internal system, or did you only learn of it when the news report came out?
I would need to get back to you to let you know exactly what they would know in that moment.
Okay, because several news sources have reported that data shows a number of line faults in your electric grid on the August the 7th and the early morning of August the 8th. And in the Washington Post, a line fault is indication a power line has come in contact with another object or was knocked down. Does Hawaiian Electric employ any kind of sensors or technologies to detect or display these faults?
Sorry, can you say the last part of your
question? Yeah, does Hawaiian Electric employ any kind of sensors or technologies to detect or display these faults?
We do have technologies to do that, but we are also investing in additional technologies to have the situational awareness of what's happening on our systems and more control and awareness for our systems.
Okay. So were any of these faults that you say you do have, I know you're looking at adding additional, but you do have fault detectors, as you said. Were any of these working on Maui on those dates? And did they alert the company that there could be an issue with some of its lines? And did anyone respond to go check out the problem?
Again, for that, I can tell you that for, in general, we had many indications of faults, and we had employees going out to look at these faults. For that particular one, I can't tell you specifically what was happening in that moment.
Okay. So also, in Hawaiian Electric's response to the committee's August 30, 2023 letter, Hawaiian Electric stated it had purchased 5 video cameras for Maui in 2023, and they are slated to be installed this year. Where does Maui Electric plan to place them? You don't have to provide specific sites. I'd like to know what your priorities are in placing the cameras you purchase.
Yeah, I understand we just got those cameras this week, and we intend to place at least some of them in West Maui. I can assure you of that.
Did you purchase the cameras because of the fire, or you did it prior to the fire? You had the cameras
I understand
ordered?
That those cameras were already ordered prior to the fire.
They just came in right after the, unfortunately. That concludes my question, so I will yield unless anyone, Chairman, need any time. Recognize the chair of the committee, subcommittee.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
I'll yield to, actually. Yeah. That's the right term.
We were just speculating on answers to me and answers to Ms. Castor. And the impression that I was left with was that you were monitoring the weather situations in advance, but then the protocols weren't triggered to in the morning. Did the people who were monitoring the weather conditions not have the authority to trigger the protocols earlier than in the morning of the fire?
They have the protocols to do that.
They have the authority to trigger the protocols.
The protocol allows them the authority to do that.
And do you know why they didn't trigger it when the storm was building up overnight? Why they didn't trigger it sooner than the next morning?
So I need to get back to you on the timing. I was indicating to you that I'm not really sure about the exact timing of when they found out about the red flag warning and when the protocol was started. And so let me get back to you on that.
All right, I appreciate that, and we would like an answer to that. But the question still remains. You knew the red flag warnings were likely to be coming, but you didn't have the protocols automatically ready to go. Now, my time's up, so I got to yield back. But that's a question I think the committee's going to want an answer to at some point.
The protocols were ready to go, just to be clear. The protocols were in place and ready to go, and they have the authority to institute it at their discretion by assessing the situation and understanding what the weather report is.
I yield back.
The chair yields back to me, and I yield back, and the chair recognizes Mr. Peters from California for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank all the witnesses for being here today under these very difficult circumstances. Our area in San Diego is familiar with devastating effects of wildfires, and you have my sympathies for what's happened to your community. And we know what it takes to rebuild, and I appreciate that you're needed at home and for what will be a long and difficult process. Due to the increasingly devastating impacts of climate change, disaster recovery efforts in general are going to need to incorporate strategies of resilience against future threats, and these efforts require a large-scale evaluation of existing grid infrastructure, specifically identifying opportunities to reduce ignition, such as through undergrounding power lines, for instance. But the risk assessment has to go beyond the threat of ignition. We need to ensure communities have sufficient evacuation routes, the defensible space around structures is prioritized and enforced, and the wildfire crisis will require a comprehensive response wherever it is faced. Mr. Glick, in your September 19th letter to the committee, you mentioned the Advanced Assistance 2.0 project. One of the listed goals is to provide Hawaii a Hawaii-specific framework for hazard mitigation and strategy implementation. What are some of the unique challenges facing grid infrastructure on Maui?
Some of the unique challenges really have to do with a coordinated approach to being able to address problems in the infrastructure, and that's at the, you know, with our home rule state. As a home rule state, we have county government sort of control of property taxes, for example, and in the counties have jurisdiction on some of the initial emergency management as well. And so part of it is ways to better coordinate when infrastructure is compromised.
Well, what's the role of the state energy office in strengthening the grid, and are you making the necessary investments to address any challenges you've identified, especially challenges that are unique to Hawaii?
Well, we provide recommendations through these working groups and through other forums that we participate in, and also participating in regulatory proceedings. And those recommendations we pursue vigorously through the process, and then we follow up afterwards with the commission, and we also work with stakeholders in the state to be able to get further.
Sure. Have you made any specific recommendations about the grid?
Well, certainly we identified, a number of grid improvements that needed to be made.
And did the state follow your recommendations in terms of making investments or committing to changes?
Well, the interesting thing is that the working group that we participated in most recently, as I've mentioned, submitted those recommendations in 2022, and the full report of the integrated grid plan was submitted in May of 2023. So the Public Utilities Commission hasn't yet had an opportunity to review and issue a decision and order.
Okay.
But we hope that will be forthcoming in the next 12 months.
Mr. Asuncion, same question. What's the role that the PUC plays in strengthening the grid, and how has been the response to your work?
Sure. Thank you for the question.
But specifically, just because I don't have a lot of time, there's a Hawaiian Electric's June 22 application to invest in $190 million over 5 years to upgrade transmission and distribution infrastructure. How's that coming?
That is coming along well. I think we, there was the filing of the application, and then there was an opportunity here for Hawaiian Electric to get some federal money to supplement that, right? And at the end of the day, it does save our ratepayers basically half the cost of the project.
Right.
My understanding is that an award was announced by the Department of Energy, and Hawaiian Electric is now talking over the exact scope for that money and how they would get that money granted to us. Okay. What we have committed to at the Public Utilities Commission is to render a decision within 90 days of the announcement of that award.
But it sounds like you appreciate the role of this infrastructure investment and of transmission with relation to fires and resiliency. And sorry that that this came as you were preparing to deal with it, it appears. So I wish you the very, very best. And we send our love and prayers to the folks in Hawaii, and I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Now recognize the gentlelady from Florida, Ms. Kamik, for 5 minutes of questioning.
Well, thank you, Chairman Griffith, for hosting this hearing today. Thank you to our witnesses for appearing before the committee on this very important topic. And, you know, as we all know, the fire brought horrific loss, and it was truly a tragedy. And for everyone who was impacted, our hearts just break and go out to everyone who has experienced loss. So it's my hope that today in this hearing that we not only get answers, the very really much needed answers for so many people, but also we can identify ways that we can avoid another tragedy. So I'm gonna start with you, Ms. Kimura, did I say that correctly? All right, thank you. So we've seen the news reports alleging that Hawaiian Electric may not have properly maintained its electrical equipment and wooden poles. So I'd like to give you an opportunity to respond to those claims. Specifically, in the response to this committee's August 30th letter, Hawaiian Electric stated that its inspection and mitigation programs on Maui to mitigate fire risk include test and treat. That is the inspection of the poles. And you further explained that as part of the test and treat program, that you were looking for indicators of strength, anchor inspection, treatment of poles for rot and termites, et cetera. Being from Florida, I know what humidity and heat and wind and salt can do to environments and assets, so I understand it's a bit more challenging. But in that report, you stated that you had performed tests and treat programs on approximately 29,000 of the 31,000 wood poles in Maui County since 2013. Why were there approximately 2,000 poles that were not subjected to that same testing?
If I could also take a moment, now that I want to clarify an earlier thing that I was talking about in terms of the timing of the red flag warning and when we instituted our protocols. So I was just able to double check on that information. So it was, the red flag warning was initiated overnight on August 7th, and by the morning of August 7th at 7 a.m., we had instituted our protocols. And so I wanted to make that clarification the day before all of this happened. And so on the polls, you are absolutely right, 29 out of 31,000 over the last 10 years. The last 2,000, my understanding is that we just hadn't gotten to those yet, and they're part of our program now. We have looked at, there was a Wall Street Journal article that talked about this recently as well, and if I could take the opportunity to
You could certainly submit that for the record. But for the purposes of time, I just really understand if any of those polls that were not tested and treated, those 2,000 plus-ish polls, if they were not part of that program over that 10-year span, were any of those polls the ones located in the areas that were struck by the fire on the 7th and the 8th?
I don't know the answer to that question right now. As we indicated, there's a lot happening right now, and we're still in response mode and haven't been able to look at all of those things. It's a very good question and something that we will look at. I can tell you that near the fire, we had looked at one of the poles, and we know that that was inspected just in 2022. So, you know, that's an indication of poles in those areas and the timing of when they were inspected.
Okay. Well, and I appreciate it. And I certainly know, again, my state, you know, my district just took a Cat 3 hurricane. And
very
so
sorry for that.
I 100% understand that recovery comes first. But I think certainly in the future, it would be very helpful to understand if those particular poles were in the area that was the initial start and subsequent spread, but then also what we can be doing for the future in terms of mitigating this issue with either composite poles, concrete, steel, looking at a variety where there's areas that are especially prone to having a weakened structure that would be helpful. I have 39 seconds, so I'm gonna jump around. I'm gonna stay with you, Ms. Kimura. The report that you issued that the county issued. The 2021, July 2021, the County of Maui Cost of Government Commission, Wildfire Prevention and Cost Recovery on Maui, that report, that's not binding, correct?
I Don't know if that's binding. I think that one was
you're aware of the
county
of
Maui. Yes, okay. I'm aware of the report. That was a report to the county of Maui.
So did anyone from the utility engage with Maui County or the cost of government commission following the report to identify a way that Hawaii Electric could help address the concerns that were laid out in this report?
Based on what I was told, we were not tasked with those recommendations from the county of Maui. That those recommendations went to personnel within the county of Maui, and we were not necessarily tasked with those recommendations. That said, what those recommendations, the content of that recommendation or those two recommendations, we were already doing that, and that's part of our wildfire mitigation plan.
My time has expired, but I think it's really important for us to nail down what happens with jurisdiction on those recommendations and who takes responsibility for them. I know you said you were implementing a number of them, but I'd like to know where the liability falls. So with that, I yield back. Thank you to our witnesses once again.
Thank you, gentlelady, for yielding back. Now I recognize the gentleman from Alabama, Mr. Palmer, for his 5 minutes of questioning.
I thank the chairman. I thank the witnesses for appearing. It's heartbreaking what happened to Lahaina, and really, really hope that you can get things worked out for those people who have suffered so much. I do look forward to hearing from my colleagues from Hawaii and my friend Jill Takuta, because I know this really hangs heavy over them. What I want to ask Mr. Asuncion is, after a rate case is decided by the Public Utility Commission, for instance, a filing to perform vegetation trimming under a power line easement, how does the commission go about verifying that the work was actually performed?
We would constantly follow up with the utility, either through reporting, which we have a variety of types of reporting, either monthly or semi-annually or annually. What we want to make sure is, how is it impacting the ratepayer, right? That the spending is in the right place, right, to take care of things, and that we see progress, right, on whatever the program is, right, versus not seeing progress.
Well, I understand that you want to look out for the ratepayer, but I have some timberland, and there's a power line goes through it, and the power company is very diligent in keeping the vegetation cut down, making sure that there's not fuel underneath the wires that could be ignited, or that if it were ignited, it would not damage the lines or the poles that support the line. And I'm up there, and I can see what's being done. People who live around there can see that. Have there been people on Maui that have reported excessive growth of vegetation? Is that something that people just weren't aware of as a potential problem for wildfire?
I will say that those types of reports would not come to the Public Utilities Commission. It might go to
But does it come to, what I need to know is if the public's reporting this to the power company, and the power, is the power company taking action? And if they don't take action, does the commission know about this?
Yeah, certainly the commission would know through the types of reporting that we have, right? I think the immediate, right, is really contingent and the responsibility of the utility, right, to act on those notices from the public.
But if they don't act on it, are there any penalties? Are there any enforcement actions that can be taken by the commission if the power company doesn't do the due diligence that I think every power company should do to make sure that they mitigate any risk for a wildfire or a harm to the public in any other way?
Yeah, certainly we do have processes in place that would, right, we could call the utility before us and to explain their actions.
Yeah, but are there any penalties?
Excuse me?
Are there any penalties? Are there fines or Is there any way to exercise enforcement if the power companies are not complying with the requirements?
Certainly, we would have to figure out either any penalties or any actions that the utility needs to make through our process.
You say you have to figure it out. That leads me to conclude that you don't have those in place now.
No, we do have those in place. Is that we have to follow our process in order to get to that level.
So if you find them out of compliance, you find them, what action do you take? Do you find the company or?
Yeah, there is a number of ways that we could make sure that the utility is accountable, is held accountable, right? And it includes everything from conditions, right, all the way up to penalties. And like I said, we use our process.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not satisfied with the answers. I would like for the witness to provide to the committee in detail the enforcement measures that the commission can impose on a utility that doesn't comply with the regulations.
Certainly, we can get that to the subcommittee.
And Mr. Asuncion is willing to provide that for the committee. We appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Now recognize Mr. Tonko for his 5 minutes of questioning.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I thank you and the ranking member for hosting this hearing, which is critically important. I know that it must be extremely difficult to be away from home right now while recovery efforts on Maui are still underway and we don't have answers to many important questions. So I do sincerely appreciate the witnesses being here to help us begin to understand how this disaster and the relief efforts unfolded. I do want to focus on the federal government's response in order to understand what support you have received and where more could be done to assist recovery efforts now and for future emergencies. My understanding is that on August 8th, the Lieutenant Governor issued an emergency proclamation and activated the Hawaiian National Guard shortly after it became clear that the Lahaina fire could not be controlled. So on August 10th, Hawaii Governor Green requested a major disaster declaration, which President Biden immediately approved. On August 18th, President Biden amended that declaration to make even more resources available for response and recovery efforts. So, Ms. Kimura, can you describe the federal involvement with recovery on Maui and what more might help support short-term recovery efforts on Maui?
Our teams are part of the Maui Emergency Operations Center, and in that center, they're working alongside, and Maui County is coordinating the resources of FEMA, of EPA, of a number of different organizations, and so all of that assistance is greatly appreciated and has made a significant impact on our state's ability to support the Lahaina community. As we move forward, I can't speak to all the day-to-day things that are needed, but as we move forward and we need to rebuild what has happened in Maui, it is going to take a lot to clear what's there, and we appreciate the assistance that's being provided for that effort, not just our things, but the entire area, and to make it safe for people to go back, because there's a lot of toxins and hazards and all of those kinds of things. So that is going to be critically important. But as we rebuild, it's going to be very expensive. And I am very concerned about how the county of Maui and the citizens of Maui are going to be able to absorb the cost of that rebuild. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where assistance from the federal government could be very helpful to that community.
Thank you. And again, Ms. Kimura, are there additional steps you would like to see Congress take to support long-term recovery efforts in Hawaii?
This is not my area of expertise, so I apologize that I can't answer specifically about the specific needs. We know that there are, you know, opportunities for federal funding, that we have a team of people looking at that, not just at our company, but at many other organizations, to ensure that we look at all opportunities to support the recovery and rebuild of Maui.
Thank you. And so I'll offer that question and direct it also to Mr. Asuncion, please.
Excuse me, could you repeat that?
Sure. Again? Are there additional steps you would like to see Congress take to support long-term recovery efforts in Hawaii?
Well, certainly I think we always appreciate what the federal government can help us with, right? Be it, you know, this particular disaster, be it other natural disasters that we have. I think we have always had a good relationship with the federal government. And, you know, in my world, I like to keep it that way. But I think, yeah, certainly, it's not only specific to Hawaii. I think all of our states that we represent, right, where we can get additional resources or assistance from the federal government, we would certainly appreciate that.
Thank you. I have other questions that I'll get to the subcommittee so as to get you to respond in writing. But I thank you all, and many of us here in Congress are committed to Maui's recovery and are willing to do anything and everything that we can to support that effort. To that end, Congress must pass President Biden's supplemental appropriations request that includes $16 billion to prevent the disaster relief fund, which is currently supporting the recovery efforts on Maui from running dry. And I look forward to hearing from my colleagues from the Hawaiian delegation, Representatives Tokuda and Case. You all have my heartfelt condolences for what you and your community are experiencing, and we are totally committed to making a difference on your behalf. With that, Mr. Chair, I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Now recognize Mr. Duncan, who's joined us. He's chairing a subcommittee upstairs, and we appreciate you coming to be a part of this subcommittee as well. Now yield to you 5 minutes for your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The hearing upstairs on grid reliability and affordability, and a lot of things we're talking about in here. First off, I want to say that our hearts and our thoughts and prayers are with the folks in Maui. Ms. Kimura, I appreciated our conversation yesterday. I could see the pain in your face by what your fellow citizens there are enduring. And so I want you to know sincerely we will continue to do all we can and continue to lift you up in thoughts and prayers. Mr. Chairman, I want to submit for the record an article from the Institute of Energy Research titled Hawaii Invest in Renewable Energy Rather Than Wildfire Prevention. Article for the record.
All right, we'll take that up at the end of the, at the meeting according to our protocols.
Thank you all for taking the time to be here. So I know it's a long trip. Ms. Kimura, it's my understanding that there were plans to build an LNG facility in Hawaii. Why did that project never come to fruition?
This was many years ago. We had been working on a proposal for LNG infrastructure in Hawaii to import it into Hawaii. And that was part of a bridge strategy that we had to get to our renewable goals, to lower costs to our customers while we transition to renewables and also to lower the carbon footprint. When we were in the process of proposing those plans, the governor of the state of Hawaii at that time had indicated that that path forward was not appropriate for Hawaii and that the focus and the investment should be on the 100, at the time I don't think it was 100% renewables, but the focus should be on achieving the renewables goals and putting the investments there.
So your dispatchable capacity comes from oil-fired now and you're using some biodiesel, I understand that.
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
Your dispatchable generation now comes from an oil plant and you're using biodiesel, and I appreciate that, but I just want for the record that they do have baseload yes. generation that is dispatchable to supplement the renewables. How would you assess natural gas affect the availability of firm generation, the affordability of electricity, and the overall level of emissions in Hawaii?
You know, that assessment was done many years ago, and I can't recall now what the impact was. We had determined at that time that it could significantly reduce the cost of electricity in Hawaii if we were able to implement that at that time. And with sufficient time from when we were proposing it to when we had to achieve our renewable goals, we felt like the investment was worth it and could amortize itself over that period of time to provide that long-term benefit to customers.
Yeah, thank you for that. For the record, I would just say that clean-burning U.S.-produced natural gas has helped the United States lower its carbon emissions. But do you think the impact of this fire will have on the cost of electricity and overall reliability of Hawaiian electric grid will change public opinion on the construction of an LNG facility?
That is hard for me to say. In Hawaii, we haven't talked about LNG for many years in Hawaii.
That conversation will come back up now?
It has not. Hawaii is very focused on achieving our current statute of 100% renewables. And as we implement our renewables agenda here, we are achieving projects. For example, a solar plus storage project that went into the ground last year was at 9 cents per kilowatt hour, and that was a third of the cost of what it would cost for fossil fuel generation based on oil. So we are continuing to pursue that route, and we are also pursuing firm generation, which we believe is needed to fill the gaps of solar and wind and storage and other renewable resources that we're implementing in Hawaii.
Just a side question, because it's not in my prepared questions here, but a thought. With the volcanic activity in the Hawaiian Islands, is thermal something that's even looked at?
Is what?
Thermal.
Yes. So we have geothermal on the Big Island of Hawaii, and that is a very important resource and a firm resource that we believe is critical to the future of Hawaii, but it's also challenging to get that resource.
Yeah, so I'd love to investigate that more. I want to ask one last question, the Maui Public Utilities. Upstairs right now, we're having a hearing on the nation's grid operators about the challenges of reliability on the grid due to state policies and how there has to be a refocus on core missions of grid operators, states, and regulators on reliability. In a similar way, given in the clear shortcomings you identified, vegetation management, in your submitted response, we also have to go back and reexamine how and whether state policies to drive energy resources to be 100% renewable may have affected priorities and or your offices and the utility away from focusing on resilience and managing risk, including mitigation fire risk.
Was that a question to me?
Yep.
So because of those cost savings that I talked about between that example I gave you, solar plus storage versus the cost of fossil fuels, oil that we've been talking about, that cost savings, given the high rates that we have in Hawaii, we can take that cost savings and we can invest that in our grid. And so that has been the strategy that we've been employing over the last many years.
Yeah. Thank you so much. I'm way over time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chairman yields back. I don't see any other members wishing to ask questions at this time, so I would like to thank our witnesses again for being here today. Now, pursuant to committee rules, I remind members they have 10 business days to submit additional questions for the record, and that would also include all the things that we asked about that you need to get back to us on, and that's fairly standard. And then I ask the witnesses that you all submit your responses to those questions and follow-ups within 10 business days of receipt of those questions. That being said, this concludes the first panel, and we will now transition to the second panel. But thank you very much for being here today. Thank you for testifying before the committee today. Our witnesses for panel two, Representative Ed Case of Hawaii's 1st District and Representative Jill Takuda of Hawaii's 2nd District. Representative Case, you're now recognized for a 5-minute statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, ranking member, members of the subcommittee. Good morning, still. Aloha. And first of all, for all of the people of Hawaii, thank you so much for your expressions of concern and for your focus in this hearing. I appear before you today as the former representative for the 2nd Congressional, which is Maui, and as one who, like so many around our country and our world, feel a deep personal sense of loss. But most importantly, I appear before you as one with my colleague, Ms. Tokuda, of our two representatives from Hawaii, because in Hawaii, we really don't think about district lines. Districts don't matter in Hawaii. Maui and Lahaina are part of all of Hawaii. And this incredible tragedy was and is a tragedy for West Maui, for Maui, but it is a deeply felt tragedy for all of our Hawaii, and we are all in for Maui. Ms. Tokuda, who's been a constant on Maui, devoted to Maui's needs since the early days of this tragedy, will describe for you a little bit more personal detail what happened, what the situation is on the ground. We'll relay some very personal stories that I hope drive home the point of the true situation and what our path must be going forward. And as you consider the testimony today and our own future path here in Congress, I'd like to leave you with about three thoughts on an overview. First of all, I agree that Congress's role and involvement is critical. In a disaster such as this, only our federal government can muster the resources and the energy and the scope of critical assistance that is going to be necessary to truly address a tragedy of this nature. And by focusing the attention and concern of Congress on the Maui disaster, you highlight the critical needs here. And I think you also highlight the path forward in terms of making sure that this doesn't happen in other communities throughout our country, because each tragedy must offer lessons to be understood and learned. Otherwise, it's simply going to be repeated, and the lives that we have lost, the community that we have lost, will be disrespected. But as this tragedy can offer lessons, at least Hawaii and those that have been lost can offer something to the rest of our country and the world. And so your focus here is really critical, and your questions have been relevant and critical, and I thank you for them. Second, the full focus of our collective efforts must remain on Maui. We are only 51 days after a very sudden and terrible tragedy, and I think it's important to understand the reality of Maui and Hawaii today. Of course, we have almost 100 confirmed dead, but we simply have not identified the remains of many, and we have many that are still missing. That effort must continue. We have a community of some 12,000, which is fully displaced, 7,800 in hotel rooms, full efforts on locating difficult-to-locate interim housing. We have a year-plus debris removal project that has only just begun. We have businesses that are devastated and only now are facing the reality of whether and how to survive. We have the full resources of our federal, state, and county governments, the community, and our congressional delegation, all focused on the necessary efforts that are required for Maui today. We have, as you know already, at least three investigations, full investigations, independent investigations, and we all know that we have a number of lawsuits that have already been filed, and these are all fact-finding exercises that in time will bring out the answers to many of the questions that this committee have asked. And all of this is where our efforts should remain for now. All of which is to say that, well, we in Congress have a very critical role, and I agree with you, Mr. Chair, it's not too early to ask these questions. We should not disrupt in what we're doing today what is necessary to be done for Maui. And so there will be a time for Congress, I think, to delve more deeply into exactly what happened and to learn the lessons of Maui when some stability has been restored. Third, how can Congress best help now, today? First of all, we ask you and encourage you to visit Maui, to see and feel for yourself this tragedy. This is something that we welcome the president, we welcome the speaker, we've welcomed already many of our colleagues. Nothing can replace that sense of understanding to do that. And second, we ask that we all collectively fund the Disaster Relief Fund by the Federal Emergency Management Agency, which is running dangerously low now. So these are two concrete areas that we can help Maui and all of us right now. But again, for Maui, for our Hawaii, my deepest appreciation for your constructive effort today for this hearing, and we completely stand ready to work with you, not only for Maui, but for the rest of our country to make sure that the lessons are learned. Thank you again.
Thank you very much for your comments, and now recognize Representative Jill Tokuda for her five-minute statement. Thank you.
Thank you. Chairman Griffith, Ranking Member Castor, Ranking Member Pallone, and members of the Subcommittee. Mahalo again for your outpouring of support and commitment to our people. And thank you for allowing us this opportunity to testify about the wildfires that have devastated our Maui Ohana. I join Representative Case in inviting you to come and truly see and experience what has happened in our community, but more importantly, work with us to rebuild and recover from the devastation. Like all of you, I want answers. Not a day has gone by since the fires that I don't ask myself questions. How did this happen? What could have been done differently? How do we make sure this never happens again? How do we keep our people, our families safe? What now? Why? Why? That's the hardest question. I've also been asked many questions myself. When can I go home? Is the air safe to breathe? How will I pay my mortgage? Who can help me rebuild my business? How do I tell my student their friend isn't coming back? One question that sticks with me came shortly after the fire. A woman approached me and asked me if I could please help her find her husband. They'd gone to all the shelters, the hospitals, they'd given the DNA sample. What should she do now? She showed me a picture of her husband's burned out truck on the side of the road and asked me why the back door was open. Could he have escaped? Where is he? I could not answer her questions that day. All I could do was hold her hand, put my arm around her, and try to comfort her. In the weeks that followed, I looked for her husband's name on every single list. First, it was on the list of the missing. A few weeks ago, identified among the dead. I share this with you because there are so many questions about this tragedy that must be answered. People want answers, people want accountability, but our people are still grieving. They are frustrated, they are grappling with their new reality, they are justifiably mad that this has even happened to them. Far too many lives were lost in our very tight-knit community. Some are still waiting anxiously of news of their loved ones, and while they want some kind of resolution, they fear that knock on the door. While it's been almost 2 months, most still have not seen the remains of their home, with the first Lahaina residents being allowed back into their property just this week. The question we need to be focused on right now is how do we keep the help coming to Maui? We are 2 days away from a shutdown. Our people have gone through enough. The wheels of government must continue to turn and work to provide them the support and the resources they so desperately need to focus on recovery and rebuilding. Last week in a House Transportation and Infrastructure Subcommittee hearing, one of our colleagues suggested that the Maui fires were the result of Hawaii's pursuit of renewable energy. He then insinuated to FEMA Administrator Criswell that the federal government should not support recovery efforts for disasters in states that pursue net zero policies. Unfortunately, these comments betray not only a lack of understanding of Hawaii's unique energy infrastructure, but also a willingness to exploit our pain and tragedy for political gain. What we already knew before this disaster is that Lahaina is not unique among rural and remote communities across our country that have not received enough investment and where ensuring access to services is a constant struggle. This tragedy has highlighted the disparities that exist in energy, telecommunications, transportation, and water infrastructure. Our rural communities lack access to healthcare, mental health services, emergency services, and more. The investments we have made through the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act and the Inflation Reduction Act must be but a first step, and we understand the urgent need to do more. The path ahead for Maui will be long and difficult. It will take years, if not generations, to recover from this disaster. Homes, schools, businesses, they will be rebuilt, but the scars of the trauma on our people, on our families, will take much, much longer to heal. As various local, state, and federal entities continue to investigate the cause of the Maui wildfires and the emergency response across all levels of government, we must not forget the human element of this tragedy. Behind the whirlwinds of investigation and litigation that have emerged from this disaster is a community still healing and fighting every day to recover and rebuild. While the historic banyan tree has become a symbol of hope, we must never forget that the people of Lahaina are her roots. There is no Lahaina without the voice, the vision of her people. Like you and I, our people have questions too. We all deserve answers. Right now, the most important question must be, how do we continue to keep the help coming to Maui? Mahalo for allowing myself and Congressman Case to testify before this committee. We will continue to count on your support and commitment in the weeks, months, and years to come. With all of you as part of now our extended Maui Ohana, I have hope that our people can and will continue to stay Maui strong. I yield back.
Thank you, gentlelady, for her comments. And appreciate each of you all being here, and know that this subcommittee will try to find answers, and that while doing so, we will not forget the human factors involved as well. Anything final?
I would. Thank you, Representative Takuda. Thank you, Representative Case. I heard you loud and clear, and on behalf of the Democratic side of the aisle, again, our sympathies are with you, but I think we can best show our sympathies by acting, by, as you said, helping get answers, making sure that the recovery continues, that the disaster relief recovery fund is fully funded, and then taking the lessons learned to help prevent this from ever happening anywhere else. And I did want to offer, this is the one-year anniversary of Hurricane Ian that hit Southwest Florida, where 150 people died, over 50 drowned because of storm surge. So they're still recovering too, as people in Puerto Rico are. Just a couple of months ago, Hurricane Idalia hit Rep. Kamek's district, but in my area, I still have people who are flooded out that have all of their belongings in pods out on the street. And what caught my attention this morning, on the front page of my hometown newspaper, the Tampa Bay Times, says FEMA has paused Florida aid. And I just, as ranking member Pallone has said, that we just cannot afford this shutdown. This story says that it's disrupted longer-term recovery projects already, without going into the shutdown that's coming this weekend. But it's what FEMA's had to do is disrupt longer-term recovery projects in Florida, Puerto Rico, and in other communities hit by past calamities, illustrating how a Republican-led standoff in Congress could unleash real hardship in Americans' lives. It's impacting the reconstruction of the grid in Puerto Rico, says the Department of Economic Development and Commerce in Puerto Rico. To prevent an interruption in federal disaster response, President Joe Biden urged lawmakers last month to restock FEMA's coffers, as Rep. Case mentioned, as part of a short-term deal to fund the government and approve an additional roughly $16 billion in supplemental aid. That money is meant to augment federal recovery efforts around the wildfire that recently ravaged Maui, the flooding this summer in Vermont, the aftermath of Hurricane Idalia. And so far, Congress has failed to act. Instead, Republicans led by House Speaker McCarthy have held up efforts to fund the government past Saturday. This is crazy. This is self-inflicted. This is not how a country as great as the United States of America should be acting. This is a gift to our adversaries. So I just urge my Republican colleagues, because I heard your very sincere sentiments, that you are here to help support the people of Maui. And the most important thing to do, it's in our power right now, since these investigations are going to be ongoing for months, the most important thing is to ensure that the people on the ground there can continue to help. And Rep. Takuda and I talked yesterday. I'd like to ask her a little question about what's going on in the recovery.
I'm not allowed to ask questions.
All right. Well, I would.
It's part of our protocol.
I would encourage everyone to talk to Rep. Takuda and Rep. Case about the extensive recovery and the missions that are on the ground. When I mentioned at the beginning of the hearing, on my way out to the Pacific Rim, we were in Honolulu on August 8th. On the way back, the United States Army gave us a briefing of their recovery, and it was, these people are heroes. They step back from kind of the national security mission to focus on the recovery of their neighbors in Maui. And these are very difficult assignments under very difficult conditions. So let's not throw a wrench into the to the recovery of people in Maui. Let's not aggravate and build, you know, pile on their pain. This can be avoided, and I just encourage you all to take that to heart while and put people over politics, because right now people look at Washington and they just see a political mess, and it's time to really think about the people all across America that are going to be impacted.
I thank the gentlelady for her comments, and not wanting to get into too much politics, but certainly welcome all the Democrat votes that we can get on Republican-led measures to keep the government open.
Mr. Chairman?
We need to bring this to a conclusion, but I would ask unanimous consent to insert into the record the documents included on the staff hearing documents list. Without objection, that will be the order.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not asking a question. I just want to make a comment, if that's all right.
Well, I know, but I made a very brief comment and then
I'll be brief.
Got a very long, although heartfelt, response. And I don't know that this is the time that we should be debating those
issues.
Well,
I just wanted to say, if I could, just I'll be like a minute.
In the sense of comedy, not comedy, but comedy, getting along, I will recognize the gentleman to make a brief comment.
Thank you. I'm not going to repeat about the shutdown. I think we all know that that's not a good thing for what's happening in Hawaii in terms of the recovery. But I did want, I know that Representative Takuda also mentioned this idea of some kind of ideological test for recovery. You know, you said that it was suggested that if you were looking to have 100% renewable, that you know, there shouldn't be funds going to Hawaii. We've heard this also in my case. Remember, in the aftermath of Sandy, there were those who were making outrageous comments about how, you know, we shouldn't help the Northeast. You know, I've been here long enough to know that whenever there's a natural disaster, we help everybody. It's not Democrat. It's not Republican. It's not ideological. It shouldn't be, right? And so I'm glad you mentioned that, but I do think we all should say that should never, there should never be a litmus test. And it's important to say that as well. And this litmus test, you know, in this case, seems to be linked to climate change. And the bottom line is that everything I see is that, you know, this dry vegetation and it was a major factor. So we can't, you know, we can't not only have a ideological test, but we all also need to recognize that one of the causes here in the long term is climate change, and that needs to be addressed as well. So
I thank the gentleman for his brief comment.
Thank you.
All that being said, without objection, subcommittee is adjourned.